So yes, now in the lab, we are interested in these lymphatic endothelial cells. I will tell you more about these cells and how they can function as immunomodulators. And today I will focus on anti-tumor immune responses. So our lymphatic system drains the peripheral tissues. Peripheral tissues to the draining lymph nodes, and they can drain fluids, lipids, macromolecules, and cells. And in particular, our immune cells that are in the peripheral tissues, they can enter these lymphatic vessels at the level of these lymphatic capillaries, in which they will adopt a crawling mode of migration to reach the lymphatic collectors. And here they will be submitted to a passive flow transport due to this very fast lymphatic flow, and also due to these valves that you can see here that maintain a unidirectional flow. And then they will reach the lymph nodes that they will enter through the subcapsular sinuses. And the cells that line these lymphatic vessels are the lymphatic endothelial cells. They are not only lining the lymphatic vessels, but they are also present in the lymph nodes. And you have to remember this PROX1 transcription factor, which is very important for lymphatic endothelial cell identity, and that we will be using a lot in our experiment to modulate these lymphatic endothelial cells. So this is at steady state, but upon an inflammation in a peripheral tissue, so that can be an infection, autoimmunity, or cancer, there will be the release in the inflamed tissue of these lymphogenic factors that are mainly VEGF-C and VEGF-D. And this release of this factor in the inflamed tissue will induce this process, which is called lymphangiogenesis, and which consists in the expansion of lymphatic endothelial cells and the enlargement of the lymphatic vasculature, which is associated to the inflamed tissue. And this will result in an increase in the drainage of these inflamed tissues to the draining lymph nodes. So this was just to present you the lymphatic vessels, but why, as immunologists, we are interested in these lymphatic endothelial cells? Because they have been shown to modulate immune responses in many different ways. So as Federica said, we first got interested in these cells because they were shown several years ago to function as antigen-presenting cells. In lymph node, it has been shown that they can present either antigens that the antigen C express or that they can capture through MHC-class1 molecules to CD8 plus T cells. And they are very important in maintaining peripheral T cell tolerance because they can present self-antigens to self-reactive CD8 T cells, and they can induce their deletion. So that will be for the T cells that have escaped the central tolerance in the thymus. So they're contributing to the maintenance of peripheral T cell tolerance. Now, whether they can also present antigens through MHC class 2 and impact CD4 T cell responses is much less clear. And this is one of the of our focus in the lab. But besides this role of functioning as antigen presenting cells, they can also produce soluble mediators. I have illustrated here the most important ones. They can produce IDO, this enzyme implicated in tryptophan catabolism, or they can produce nitric oxide and therefore inhibit T cell proliferation. But they can also influence immune cell trafficking by producing some chemokines such as CCL21 or the sphingosine 1 phosphate. And it has been shown also that they can produce CSF1, serving as a niche in the lymph node for subcapsular macrophages. So they can impact the proliferation, the migration, also the survival of immune cells by producing all these factors. And today I will show you what we think they are doing in the tumor microenvironment. Indeed, we are very interested in targeting the tumor stroma, so the non-hematopoietic tumor stroma, because it has been shown that their manipulation could impact anti-tumor immunity and also immune response to immunotherapy. So why it could be interesting is that because although these immunotherapy approaches are very promising nowadays, several patients, they do not respond, experience therapeutical benefit from this therapy. And there are several evidence now in the literature that by targeting the non-immune tumor stroma And combining this with the immunotherapy, current immunotherapy approaches, and that could be very, very relevant. So these non-immune tumor stromal cells are the cancer-associated fibroblasts that we mentioned briefly during your defense, and also the blood vessels and the lymphatic vessels. And we are very interested in these lymphatic vessels that are associated to the tumor, the development of the tumor. Indeed, this process of lymphangiogenesis that I was mentioning before in an inflamed tissue, which is an enlargement of the vasculature associated to this inflamed tissue, is also happening during the development of solid tumors. And so this is because there will be the release in the tumor microenvironment of these lymphangiogenic factors that I was telling you before. So these factors can be produced either by tumor cells or by immune cells as well. Macrophages can produce VGFC, for instance. And then this process of tumor-associated lymphangiogenesis has been correlated with bad prognosis because this is the route that tumor cells they take to spread and to form metastasis first in the tumor-draining lymph node and later on in the distant organs. However, these lymphatic vessels are also the route that dendritic cells they take to migrate from the primary tumor after they have captured tumor antigens to migrate to the tumor-draining lymph node and to initiate anti-tumor T-cell responses. So there is really this dual role of these lymphatic vessels that can, in one hand, promote tumor metastasis, but also are crucial for the initiation of anti-tumor T-cell responses. And we have shown several years ago that these lymphatic endothelial cells that are in the tumor-draining lymph node, they can cross-present, so they can capture tumor antigens and cross-present them to anti-tumor CD8 T-cells in order to induce their deletion. So in the tumor-draining lymph node, it looks like they function as tolerogenic antigen-presenting cells by inducing the deletion of anti-tumor CD8 cells. And we haven't deciphered precisely the mechanism, but it looks to be related to their high expression of PD-L1, that they could function as tolerogenic antigen-presenting cells. So now we are more interested in the lymphatic endothelial cells in the primary tumor themselves. And what was shown at the time we started, I will be very fast for the first, I will show you briefly and summarize some studies that are already published, and then I will present you some ongoing work that we have in the lab. So what was shown at the time we started these studies is that when lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumor microenvironment, they are exposed to gamma interferon, which is produced by immune cells, they upregulate PD-L1. And as I said, for the lymph node, it was happening in the tumor as well. By interacting with PD-1 expressing CD8 T cells, it was inducing their deletion or their exhaustion. But because MHC class II molecules are also inducible by gamma interferon, we wonder if LEC in the tumor microenvironment could upregulate MHC class II and impact the CD4 T cell responses as well. So for these studies, we are using in the lab a lymphangiogenic tumor mouse models because not all the tumors are highly lymphangiogenic, depend on the amount of lymphangiogenic factors that are produced in the tumor microenvironment. And in order to push the system, we generated lymphangiogenic tumors. So for that, we use the well-known B16F10 melanoma that express OVA as a tumor model antigen and that we engineer to overexpress VGFC. And as you can see here by flow cytometry, so the lymphatic endothelial cells, they are CD45 negative, they are non-hematopoietic cells, and they are also GP38 positive and CD31 positive. And you can see that in contrast to the parental tumors that are poorly lymphangiogenic, we expand the lymphatic endothelial cell population in our lymphangiogenic tumors. It's here by FACS, but you can see here also on the tumor sections, where the lymphatic, they were stained with a live one marker, but in red, you can see that we increase the lymphatic vessels in these tumors. So by using this, we looked at the T cells, and just to summarize a long story, we found that the regulatory T cells, so these cells that are suppressive cells that can inhibit T cell responses, were in close interaction with these lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumor. So in order to understand this better, what we did, we generated mice in which MHC class II molecules were abrogated selectively in lymphatic endothelial cells, and for that we cross MHC class II flox mice with PROX1 CRI-ERT2 mice. So you remember I told you that PROX1 is this transcription factor important for lymphatic endothelial cells identity. And then when we treat these mice with tamoxifen, we can induce the deletion of MHC class II specifically in lymphatic endothelial cells. So this is the case here, as you can see, in the conditional knockout, the lymphatic endothelial cells, they don't express MHC class II in the tumor, but also in the lymph nodes. And when we transplanted our lymphangiogenic tumors in these conditional knockout mice, we found that they developed smaller tumors. And we could observe that it was due to impaired regulatory T cell function. So when we extracted the T-Rex from these tumors in which LEC express or not MHC class II molecules, we found that the transcriptome of these T-Rex in the conditional knockout were significantly different. And in particular, they downregulated several genes that are very important for regulatory T cell functions, such as IL-10, ICOS, PD-1, CTLA-4, et cetera, et cetera. So they have an impaired transcriptome, but they have also impaired suppressive function. We tested their functionality ex vivo, so we sorted the regulatory T cells from these tumors, either from the control tumors or from the tumor in which LEC do not express MHC class II. And we co-culture them with T cells that we induce to proliferate. And here, this is just different T-reg naive T-cell ratio. And you can see here in blue that the T-regs isolated from the conditional knockout, they are less competent at inhibiting the proliferation of other T-cells compared to T-regs isolated from the control tumors. So these T-regs, they have impaired suppressive function in the conditional knockout. And as a consequence, we found that the effector T-cells in these tumors in the conditional knockout, they were increased. You have less CD4 producing gamma interferon, CD8 producing gamma interferon, and granzyme B. And we believe this is why we have this decrease in tumor growth. So just to summarize this this part, what we found is that when they are exposed to gamma interferon produced by immune cells in the tumors, these lymphatic endothelial cells, they not only upregulate PD-L1, to induce depletion of CD8 T cells, but they also upregulate MHC class II molecules to promote the suppressive functions of the T-Rex. So it's like they take advantage of the immune responses in the tumor to dampen this anti-tumor immunity. However, it has been shown by other labs that these lymphatic vessels, this tumor-associated lymphangiogenesis, could be beneficial for immunotherapy. For instance, it has been shown that lymphangiogenic tumors, they respond better to anti-PD-1 blockade. So in order to decipher what would be the impact of this immunotherapy, like the impact of increasing anti-tumor immune responses on these lymphatic vessels, we decided to use the approach of adoptive T-cell transfer therapy. And for that, we use advantage of the fact that our tumors express OVA. And we transferred in these tumor-bearing mice OVA-specific effector T-cells that we generate in vitro. And then we transfer high numbers of these effectors in these tumors. And when we look at the lymphatic vessels in these tumors, we found that the density of LEC was significantly impaired. And that was a consequence of this LEC undergoing apoptosis, as you can see here by flow cytometry upon OT1 effector OVA-specific T-cell transfer. We found that LEC, they upregulated the Kliefka space 3. So they undergo apoptosis. And we confirmed this was by fax, but we confirmed this also on tumor sections. You have here the lymphatic endothelial cells that are in red. You have the cytotoxic T cells, OT1, that are in green and that are interacting with these lymphatic endothelial cells. And you see that this LEC, they upregulate the Kliefka space 3. So they undergo apoptosis. And what was super interesting is that we could determined that this killing of LEC by cytotoxic T cell was antigen dependent. Indeed, you see here by flow cytometry, this is gated on lymphatic endothelial cells in tumors, and you can see that the LEC that express the Kliefka space 3, they also express MHC class 1 OVA peptide complexes. So I'm not showing you everything, but just to summarize, what we could show is that when we transfer this effector, anti-tumor effector T cells, there will be the killing of tumor cells, the release of tumor antigens, and these tumor antigens, they can be captured by lymphatic endothelial cells and cross-presented, and they become themselves targets for cytotoxic T lymphocytes, and they are being killed by the cytotoxic T lymphocytes. And all this results in the reduction of lymphatic endothelial cell density in this tumor and the dismantling of the lymphatic vasculature, which is associated to this tumor. And why we think it's important is that the dismantling of this lymphatic vasculature associated to the tumor results in a decrease in lymph node metastasis. As you can see here, these are draining lymph node sections that we stain for GP100, that's a melanoma marker. And you see that upon OT1 T-cell transfer, we have much less metastasis compared to untransferred mice. So this is nice because when you increase T-cell responses against tumor, you can not only kill the cancer cells, which is the aim, but you can also kill the lymphatic endothelial cells that are associated to the tumor and prevent metastasis in the tumor-draining lymph node. So this is nice, but this is only happening at very high T-cell density, which is unfortunately most of the time not the case. So we are still very interested in understanding better the immunomodulatory functions of these lymphatic endothelial cells in tumors. So I show you already this lymphogenic tumor mouse model that we are using in the lab, these B16 OVA tumors that overexpress or not VGFC. And Julien Angelillo, an MD PhD in the lab, recently generated another lymphogenic tumor model, which is MC38 colorectal carcinoma, also expressing OVA and overexpressing or not VGFC. And we have published already several years ago that the lymphangiogenic B16 OVA that overexpress VGFC, they develop larger tumors compared to the parental B16 OVA tumors. So this was published, and to our surprise, when we look at the growth of the tumor in the other model, the MC38 OVA model, we see now that the lymphangiogenic version develop very small tumors compared to the parental MC38 OVA. And I'm not showing you, but these differences between the lymphangiogenic and the parental tumors in both models, whether it is increased or decreased, depending on the model, these differences are abrogated in immunodeficient mice, showing that lymphatic endothelial cells, depending on the tumor microenvironment, they can exert either immunosuppressive or pro-immunogenic functions. So to understand this better, Julien has sorted these lymphatic endothelial cells from lymphangiogenic melanoma or from lymphangiogenic MC38 tumors and performed RNA sequencing. And you see here that the lymphatic endothelial cells are isolated from the two different tumors. They cluster separately and also separately compared to the lymphatic endothelial cells that were isolated from steady state skin as a control. Then when we look more into the gene ontology pathway with the high establishment score, we found that in MC38 over VGFC, 40 of this pathway were immunologically relevant. And we further classify these pathways into 5 different categories: inflammation, migration, innate, and adaptive immunity. And then when we look into the genes that are that belong in this pathway, we found that indeed the lymphatic endothelial cells, they upregulated a set of genes compared to lymphatic endothelial cells in the B16 OVA tumor. So they are very, very different and also different from the lymphatic endothelial cells in the skin. And now we are very interested in deciphering these genes and whether they are important for the immunomodulatory functions of these lymphatic endothelial cells. And among these genes, we have several interesting ones, such as 6CL10, L33, SKR4, L15, and others. And this is upon investigation. So these lymphatic endothelial cells, depending on the tumor microenvironment, they can upregulate or downregulate some genes, but some other genes are simply upregulated in the two different tumors. So this was for the genes that are differentially regulated, but some are simply upregulated in the tumors, and this is also in other tumors, we verify that. So it looks like this enzyme, for instance, which is a cholesterol 25 hydroxylase, CH25H, is upregulated by lymphatic endothelial cells in MC38 OVA VGFC tumors, but also in B16 OVA VGFC tumors, and we found this also in other tumor mouse models, such as breast cancer. So what is this enzyme? It's an enzyme implicated in the cholesterol metabolism. It's inducing the oxidation of cholesterol into 25-hydroxycholesterol. And why we think it might be related to the immunomodulatory function of lymphatic endothelial cells is that when we extracted TCGA data, we found that in melanoma patients, the expression of the enzyme in the tumor microenvironment was positively correlated with the lymphatic vessel signature in these tumors in these patients. So the lymphatic vessel signature was established as podoplanin, VGFC, and NIV1 positive, which are all lymphatic markers. So we have a positive correlation in these patients that have high lymphatic vessel signature and the expression of CH25H. Interestingly, when we looked at the overall survival in these patients, when we separated them into high or low CH25H expressors, we found that there is a modest improvement of the survival in the patient that have high expression of the enzyme. But what was more interesting for us is that when now we focus specifically on the patient that were treated with immune checkpoint blockade, here it was a combo anti-PD-1 and anti-CTLA-4, we found that now there is a great improvement of the overall survival and progression-free survival in this patient that express high levels of CH25H. So that suggests that the expression of the enzyme allow a better response to immunotherapy. So what is known about this 25-hydroxycholesterol or oxysterol in general in the tumors? Not much. Actually, this 25-hydroxycholesterol has been shown to be very important for antiviral immunity because it's affecting the lipid membrane, the bilayer membrane of the cells, and it's preventing the interaction between the virus and the cells. So it's inhibiting the entry of the virus in the cells. But in the tumor context, it's not much is known. In vitro, it has been shown that it can have either pro or anti-tumorogenic effect, but that was only in vitro. And in vivo, there is mainly these three studies that were published recently by the same lab. So the first two, they show that the expression of CH25H in the tumor microenvironment will inhibit the release of tumor-derived extracellular vesicles, and therefore will inhibit or will decrease metastasis in distant organs. And the second paper has shown that the expression of CH25H in endothelial cells will decrease angiogenesis, so the expansion of the blood vessels associated to the tumor, therefore, again, inhibiting metastasis. And the same lab very recently has published that the expression of the enzyme in cytotoxic T lymphocytes prevents them from the thrombocytosis of tumor cells and therefore prevent them from being killed by other cytotoxic T lymphocytes. So acting as a pro-anti-CD8 T cell response. So in order to determine whether the expression of the enzyme in lymphatic endothelial cells has an impact on antitumor immunity and tumor growth, we generated in collaboration with some groups in Lausanne this reporter mice that are CH25H GFP and that are also flanked with LOXP-cyte. So when we transplanted our mice with our B16 OVA VGFC tumors, and we look at the expression of the GFP, so the expression of the enzyme by different cells in the tumor, we found that indeed the lymphatic endothelial cells, together with the blood endothelial cells, but this has been published before, are the main expressor of this enzyme. So we decided to abrogate the expression of the enzyme, specifically in lymphatic endothelial cells, in order to see the impact on antitumor immunity and tumor growth. So for that, we crossed the CH25A GFP mice, FLOX mice, with PROX1 CRI ERT2, And upon tamoxifen treatment of these mice, we can abrogate the expression of CH25H in lymphatic endothelial cells. So we first confirmed this, of course. So we inoculated the tumors into control and conditional knockout mice. And then when we look in the tumor, we found that by looking at the GFP signal, indeed, we found that lymphatic endothelial cells, the expression of the enzyme is almost completely abrogated, as you can see here. But what was more important for us is that when we dose the 25-hydroxycholesterol, so the product of the enzyme in the tumor themselves, ex vivo, we found that the levels of 25-hydroxycholesterol were significantly impaired in the conditional knockout. So that was very important because that showed that in these tumors, at least, lymphatic endothelial cells are the major source of extracellular 25-hydroxycholesterol. Then when we followed the growth of the tumor, we found that the conditional knockout, they developed slightly but significantly a bigger tumor compared to the control. And we could confirm this in two other tumor mouse models, MC38 and EO771, which is a breast cancer model. So there is an increase in the tumor growth. And what was important is that when we crossed our conditional knockout mice with NSG mice, so immunodeficient mice, we completely abrogate the difference in the tumor growth, meaning that lymphatic endothelial cells, by producing 25-hydroxycholesterol, impact antitumor immunity. So we next look at the immune infiltrate in these tumors. And in the B16 of VGFC model, what we could see is that indeed the ratio between CD45 positive cells and tumor cells was reduced in the conditional knockout. However, when we tried to look more into the T cells, we could not find any significant difference. It was a slight tendency for effector T cells producing gamma interferon or granzyme B, etc., but nothing significant. So maybe altogether this explained the small difference in the tumor growth, but it was nothing really not noticeable. However, when we look in MC38 ova tumors, we found that indeed in this model we have impaired effector T cell responses with less CD4 plus T cells producing gamma interferon and less CD8 T cells producing gamma interferon, TNF and granzyme B. And we found an increased expression in PD-1. So we reasoned that if we see something in these MC38 tumors, which are known to be more immunogenic compared to B16 ova tumors, maybe by increasing the immunogenicity of the B16 ova VGFC tumor, we could see better differences. So to do that, what we did was to vaccinate the mice with OVA as a tumor model antigen and CpG as an adjuvant. And we vaccinated this B16 ova VGFC tumor-bearing mice, either the control or the conditional knockout mice. So now in terms of tumor growth, we see a better difference between the two groups. So as you can see at the beginning, both the control mice and the conditional knockout mice, they can control the growth of the tumor compared to unvaccinated animals. But then you can see that there is a relapse of the tumor growth in the conditional knockout mice, where the control mice, they can still control the growth of the tumor. When we analyze the immune infiltrate, we found something very striking is that in the myeloid cells, so this is gating on total CD68 and CD11B positive cells, so this includes monocytes and macrophages, we found that there is a balance in the phenotype of these cells. We found in the tumor in the conditional knockout mice less iNOS positive pro-inflammatory myeloid cells and more CD206 anti-inflammatory myeloid cells. And we observe also a strong reduction in effector CD8 T cell responses that produce less gamma interferon and TNF alpha, whereas we have a more exhausted phenotype with more CD8 T cells expressing PD-1 and TIM-3. So in order to determine whether these myeloid cells are the target cells of 25-hydroxycholesterol that are modulated, and as a consequence, we have a modulation of effector T cell responses, we decided to deplete these myeloid cells. And for that, we use an anti-CSF1R antibody. And what we observed is that when we deplete these myeloid cells, indeed, we completely abrogate the difference in the tumor growth between the control mice and the conditional knockout mice. And now we have the wild type mice that behave as a conditional knockout mice, like if by depleting these myeloid cells, we depleted a good myeloid cell, pro-inflammatory myeloid cell population. And as a consequence on effector CD8 T cell responses, now in the wild type, they are strongly reduced. So indeed, it looks like by depleting these myeloid cells, we deplete a good pro-inflammatory myeloid population that was promoting effector T cell responses. And now we have an exhausted phenotype in these T cells in the wild type as well when we depleted the myeloid cells. So we really think that these myeloid cells, they are the first, they are the target cells for 25-hydroxycholesterol that is produced by lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumor microenvironment and that promote their anti-tumoral functions. But we haven't deciphered the mechanism yet. So the last thing we tried was to compensate the lack of 25-hydroxycholesterol in the tumors in the conditional knockout, because I just show you that in this conditional knockout in which leg do not express CH25H, the levels of 25-hydroxycholesterol was significantly impaired. So we did that in this setting as a conditional knockout that were inoculated with V16-OVA VGFC tumors, vaccinated with OVA plus CPG, and then we intratumorally injected 25-hydroxycholesterol. And we found that that was enough to restore, that's preliminary data, we have to repeat, but it looks like it's enough to restore the control of the tumor growth in the conditional knockout now. And what was nice is that this was associated with an increase in the frequency of iNOS-positive myeloid cells, these cells that we believe to be important and promoted by 25-hydroxycholesterol released by lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumors. So now what we are doing, we sorted the myeloid cells from the tumors in both wild type and conditional knockout mice, and we are performing single-cell RNA sequencing, and we are waiting for the result. But in the meantime, we're trying to understand what's happening, and we might have a candidate pathway. It has been shown several years ago that if you inject LXR agonist in a tumor-bearing mice, that will induce the production of ApoE, and ApoE will bind myeloid cells, myeloid-derived suppressor cells, to inhibit them and lead to a reinvigoration of anti-tumor T-cell immunity. And why we think that this pathway might be implicated in our study is because we know that 25-hydroxycholesterol is a natural ligand for LXR. So we think that maybe 25-hydroxycholesterol by binding to LXR will promote the production of ApoE and will impair these myeloid-derived suppressor cells and promote the pro-inflammatory myeloid cells. So in order to test that, we crossed ApoE flox mice with LYZ2 Cre mice to abrogate ApoE in myeloid cells. And we applied the same protocol, the tumor inoculation and the vaccination. And what we observed, so now it's not preliminary anymore because we have three experiments. We observed that these conditional knockout mice in which myeloid cells do not express ApoE, they cannot control the growth of the tumor to similar extent compared to the control mice. They are much less efficient in controlling the growth of the tumor. So, of course, we still need to make the link with 25-hydroxycholesterol produced by lymphatic endothelial cells, but we believe that this pathway might be implicated, and we are working on that. So to summarize and to finish on this study, which is still ongoing, we found that lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumor microenvironment, they upregulate CH25H. So we don't know yet what is inducing the upregulation of this enzyme by LEC in the tumor microenvironment. What we know is that it doesn't look to be mediated by immune cells because we see this upregulation of the enzyme in lymphatic endothelial cells in the tumor in the NSG immunodeficient mice as well. So it doesn't seem to be induced by immune cells. And then when they upregulate the enzyme, it's inducing the release of 25-hydroxycholesterol extracellularly in the tumor microenvironment and somehow promote iNOS-positive myeloid cells and decrease CD206 myeloid cells that are the immunosuppressive one, and that will positively impact effector T-cell responses and better control the growth of the tumor. So this is the working hypothesis that that we have now, and we're trying to decipher better. Okay, so to conclude, I want to thank my lab. I did not mention, but this oxysterol part was performed by Imen Jusun. She's a very talented PhD student, and I show you also work from Julien Angelillo. And the first published part was performed by Laure Garnier. And I'd like to thank my collaborators, financial support, and you for your attention. And I'm happy to take questions.